So here we are seeing Maitreya Rishi is explaining about that incident when Kardama Muni left his household life and renounced his family life, and as a sannyasi he left to the forest. At that time, his grown-up son, Lord Kapila, he stayed back in that house at Bindu Sarovar, and Matuhu Priya Chikirshaya, in order to please his mother, Devahuti, he stayed back in the house. So, in the purport, Prabhupada is explaining something very important. In the absence of the father, it is the duty of the grown-up son to take charge of his mother and serve her to the best of his ability so that she will not feel separation from her husband. So, there are two duties. One is of the son and one is of the father. Father, or in this case, father of Kapila and husband of Devahuti. So as a husband, it is his duty that he does not remain in household life forever. That is according to the Vedic system. Vedic culture was so arranged that gradually one gives up attachment for this material affection, for this material world, by simultaneously becoming attached to the Supreme Lord. So it was required that at a certain stage of life, one gives up all family connections, even externally, and dedicate his whole life only for the Supreme Lord. Because other times, there are different kinds of other duties, household duties are also there. And in the absence, it is the duty of elder son to take care of the mother, Matuhu Priya Chikirshaya, to serve her to the best capacity so that she does not feel separation from the husband. And we can see that how Mother Devahuti will inquire from Lord Kapila about the truth of life. And in the next verse itself, it is said, when Kapila, who could show her the ultimate goal of absolute truth, was sitting leisurely before her, Devahuti remembered the words of Brahma had spoken to her. She therefore began to question Kapila. So she inquires about spiritual life, and Lord Kapila, being duty bound, he explains this spiritual truth, which is called Tattva Marga, the ultimate goal of life. So, Prabhupada says, this is very important. One should not remain continually implicated in household affairs up to the time of death. In human life, it is a great opportunity that actually we can become cleansed of material affection, we can cut off the ties of material affection and regain our pure Krishna consciousness. All the Vedic literature say this valuable human life should not be wasted in material attachments. All other life we have wasted being attached to this material sense object, illusory sense objects, trying to squeeze out pleasure from matter. In all other lives we have been trying. And it's only in human life that one can take advantage of the facilities given and he can cut off these material affections. To that effect, this Varnashrama system was so arranged that gradually one becomes detached. There are some very beautiful prayers which are offered by Muchukunda when he saw the Lord face to face. We have heard about Muchukunda. He was sleeping for days together, and when he came before the Lord, so the Lord was very pleased with him. And the Lord said, you can ask me any benediction you want. So that time he starts praying to the Lord. Some very beautiful prayers he offered. So he says there, my dear Lord, I can see that all living entities, they are illusioned by your external energy. Maya Mohita. We all know the living entities are captured, illusioned by the external energy. What do? When they are so captured, they are so enamored, they work hard for illusory happiness and sense gratification. So what happens? When they become so much engrossed in search after illusory happiness in the material world, result is they are reluctant to worship the lotus feet of the Lord. That is the result. See, it is very important to understand. These two things do not go simultaneously. Material enjoyment and spiritual advancement does not go together. When one is enamored by material enjoyment, he forgets the Supreme Lord. That is the result of material enjoyment. And then he says, so then what happens when one forgets, one does not, he is unaware of, he is reluctant to worship the Supreme Lord. Then what happens? When he is unaware of this, he forgets that actually all his material existence, miserable conditions of material existence, are because he is not worshipping the Supreme Lord. Nate vidu swarth gatim hi Vishnum. He is trying to enjoy, but actually he faces only miserable condition of life because he does not know my real swartha, my real welfare is to worship the Supreme Lord. And if he neglects that, only material existence, painful material existence he undergoes. Then he says, what all he becomes attached to, the living entity becomes attached to in illusion, society, friendship, love, and all of them produces varieties of miseries of material life. He actually becomes attached to them thinking, I will be happy. But the result is only miseries. You see, and thus what happens? Not only the living entity suffers, he is so attached, he cannot understand in this illusion, he is suffering. So much illusion. Then Prabhupada gives the example, a pig is eating stool, but actually he cannot understand that he is suffering. Only when we come to the life of human being, and from there when we look at the life of a pig, then we can understand his suffering. But pig himself is not able to understand his position. This is our position. Being attached to love, friendship, society, friends, all these things, we are so much in illusion. Actually we are suffering, but we are not able to see the suffering. We are not able to realize that suffering. So Prabhupada says, thus this society is called society of cheaters and cheated. And then King Muchukunda, he gives the example. He says, their life is like an animal which has fallen into a deep and dark well, enamored by some green grass. So Prabhupada very nicely explains what happens, that sometimes there are wells which are not used for a long time, and those wells, they become covered with green grass because of being not used for a long time. So some foolish animal, they're enamored by that green grass on the well, and they fall into that trap, and they fall into that deep and dark well. Similarly, the living entities are enamored by sense enjoyment, and they fall into the deep and dark well of sense gratification in this material world. And what happens when they fall in such a deep and dark well? Even though he suffers like anything, he cannot come out. It is so dark. And even if he shouts, no one can hear. That is the meaning of blind well, deep, dark well. He is shouting like anything and nobody is able to make out. Nobody can hear. So that is the position. And then further, he explains, my position is also like that, Muchukunda says. A normal man, he is attached to his small family, to his small position. He says, I am doing the same thing on a bigger and a larger scale. One man is thinking, I am the proprietor of this body, I am the proprietor of my house. I was thinking, I am the proprietor of the whole state. And enamored by false ego, I used to travel places to places, winning different kingdoms, expanding my kingdom. So expanding my illusion more and more. On a larger scale, same thing I was doing. And then further he says, how much anxiety one has to take. Poor man is thinking, my anxieties will be finished. How much illusion it is in this material world. Poor man is thinking, if I get rich, my anxieties will be over. And in order to earn that, to become rich, so much hard work he does, he has no time to enjoy. So while working for the riches, he has no time to enjoy. He takes so much of anxiety, so much of pain. And then when he gets into that position, he is still not free from anxiety. Different kind of anxiety now encompasses him. Now he is thinking, I've got so much wealth, whether it should not be looted. always constantly in anxiety if somebody else will take away this wealth. Government may take away, tax collector, so much of anxiety. So he's saying, where is the living entity when he becomes free from such anxieties? And then he has done so much of hard work, but my dear Lord, you are never lenient in your duties. You are very strict in your duties. As the time factor, you take away all that whatever one has earned. Big kingdom, big opulence, everything, whatever one may have collected, as time factor, you take away everything. See how foolish the living entity is actually. So much enamored, so much hard work, no freedom from anxiety, finally everything to be taken away by time. This is the result. So, he is saying to the Lord, my dear Lord, then why are you asking me to take material benediction? This is the result. I may be a great king now. I may have opulences now. I may be wearing a gold bangle, gold necklace and crown, going everywhere, being praised as a king, decorated like a king. But the same body, when it will lie in crematorium, it will be eaten away by animals, or it will become like earth. So much illusion. While one is living, how much he cares for this body. The body which is going to be eaten away by insects, the body which will decompose in the earth, so much care one has to take about. So he's saying, my dear Lord, why are you asking me to take some material benediction? This is the final result. But then he says, my dear Lord, you are sometimes very merciful. That even though one may be in such a deep and dark well, somehow or other, if he gets association of a pure devotee, then his path to liberation becomes opened up. You see? Just like in Bhagavad Gita it is said, no? That lust, greed, anger, all these are paths to hell. But association of pure devotee, then our gateway, our path to liberation from this material world opens up. And he says, it is just because, my dear Lord, of your arrangement that I was able to come in contact with a pure devotee, great soul like Garga Muni. And because of his arrangement, my dear Lord, you have given me complete renunciation. I have become detached. So many saintly people are trying to become detached by themselves, and still it is so difficult for them to become detached. Sometimes voluntarily they give up. We see example of Bharat Maharaj voluntarily giving up. Buddha as a prince voluntarily renouncing his kingdom. He said, my dear Lord, I did not have to do anything. By your mercy you have taken away everything. So what happened was, Muchkunda, he was, by the arrangement of the Lord, he was engaged in battle with demons on behalf of demigods. So while he was fighting in the heavenly kingdom, the time on earth passed away, and no more his family, no more his kingdom, no more his wife, children, everything gone. So, you know, the demigods spoke to him. They said that, what are you going to do by going back? You have fought enough for us now. We are very happy with you. What do you want? We are very pleased. Take some benediction. But don't take any benediction because your everything is gone, already finished. What will you do going back? So he said, okay, give me benediction. I can sleep a lot because I have not taken rest. What else I want? Because you anyway, you cannot give me benediction of getting. They themselves said, except for mukti, you can take any other benediction, whatever you want. So he said, okay, I am very tired now fighting on your behalf. Give me benediction, I can sleep nicely. And if somebody disturbs my sleep, I should be able to burn him to ashes. You see. So that is how you find Muchukunda. He came in that cave, and by the arrangement of the Lord, he killed Kalyavan. And then the Lord was pleased with him, and he offered this beautiful prayer. So he said, my dear Lord, I am already bereft, I am already a Tyagi, everything is already taken away. So I do not want anything. If you want, give me the benediction that I may be engaged with my mind, with my words, with my body, just in your service. So then Krishna benedicted him. Krishna gave him that benediction that yes, in this life, three modes of material nature will not touch you. You'll be out of three modes of material nature. And after giving up this body, in the next life, you will become my great devotee. So that was the benediction Krishna gave him. So we can see the same thing Prabhupada is saying. That is how the Vedic life was arranged. That one does not remain continuously implicated in household affairs of life up to the time of death. That is how it was arranged. So we can see the same thing here, that Kardama Muni has left so that completely now he can devote his time meditating on the Supreme Lord. And in his place now his son is there, he is grown up. So Prabhupada gives an example. Imagine person, actually that is how the Vedic life was. Around 25 years of age, if somebody wants to get into grihastha life, that is a good age. So that by the time his son, let us say by 25, if he gets married and within 1 year he gets a son. By the time he is 50, his son is grown up to around 25. So Prabhupada says approximately that was the age of Lord Kapila. So he was able to take care of his family, responsibilities, everything. And then Kardama Muni was free now to completely dedicate his life for the Supreme Lord. So we'll stop with this. Grantara Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai. Guru Srila Prabhupada ki jai.